This week on WealthTrack, Nobel laureate economist Robert Shiller on home prices, stock prices, and the stories driving the economy.
The idea that the stock market is trending upward, and maybe for good reason, there's the stay-at-home, the working-at-home mantra that's going around.
Right.
Maybe this is a fundamental change in the economy that we'll learn from what we're doing, and everything will be wonderful.
A conversation with Yale professor Robert Shiller is on the next Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
Funding provided by Morgan Le Fay Dreams Foundation, Clearbridge Investments, Royce Investment Partners, Matthews Asia, First Eagle Investment Management, and Strategus Asset Management.
Hello and welcome to this New Year's edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. We have a special treat for you today, an interview with Robert Shiller, a Nobel Prize-winning economist, a pioneer in the field of behavioral finance, longtime Yale professor, financial innovator, and prolific author. Among his best-selling tomes are Irrational Exuberance, published just before the tech bubble burst, Animal Spirits, which came out as the housing bubble-induced global financial crisis was unfolding, and more recently, Narrative Economics, How Stories Go Viral and Drive Major Events. Shiller's also the co-creator of the widely cited gauge of U.S. housing prices, the Case-Shiller Home Price Index, and creator of the cyclically adjusted P.E. ratio, known as the CAPE ratio, which is a price-earnings ratio for the S&P 500 based on average inflation-adjusted earnings from the previous 10 years. Because it includes 10 years of earnings, many consider it to be a more reliable gauge of market value. I am honored to say Bob has also been a guest on WealthTrack since the very beginning, and we always cherish his time with us. His presence could not be more timely. He is known for identifying the tech and housing bubbles long before anyone else did, and here we are in the midst of an economy-crushing pandemic with home prices booming and stock prices hitting new records. We started with the stock market, his view of the record-setting performance.
What's driving it has been a mystery. And it certainly has something to do with changing narratives. People can see public attitudes changing. But the problem is, we haven't until recently been able to measure these narratives, or it's all kind of personal opinion. And so it's hard. And I have been trying to understand the narratives behind this, this recent stock market boom. So I'll give you an example of a narrative that seems to be operative now. Narratives have this form of stories, human interest stories. People love human interest.
Right.
They don't like to look at charts and graphs and equations. Most people don't. So it has to be presented in a way like an advertisement, you know, a story about humans. So one story that has been prominent, I think, is the story of the previous financial crisis, 2007-2009, and a particular humanized version of that about the stock market, which reached its bottom in March 2009. Now, I know, because I was doing questionnaire surveys then, that people were very much afraid of a 1929 stock market crash. That was an old narrative that was coming back. And because of the reminder of the recent bank failures, it seemed like 1929 all over again. So there was a huge spike in concern about that. And people were afraid. A lot of them were pulling their money out of the market because they feared a 1929 style crash.
Huh.
And now they're regretting it because it turns out it was a horrible time to pull it. That was March of 2009 was the perfect time to put your money into the market, because the stock market essentially tripled after that. So people are kicking themselves for making that mistake. So I think we had a depression scare between February 19th and March 23rd of this year.
Right, of 2020.
Yeah, connected with COVID-19. Maybe, you know, people got scared again.
Right.
And they started selling and they made the same mistake again, or so it seemed. By March of 2020, and the market started going up. So people started to think, I think this was the story. I regret so much that I didn't recognize the opportunity after the market had fallen. This time, I'm not going to make that mistake again. And so they started buying. And so they get in even late. And that's what happened.
Okay. But, you know, in the case of March of 2020, it did seem like the world was ending because government was shutting down swaths of the economy, you know, all over the world. So there was a reason to be concerned. I talk to Wall Street people all the time, and, you know, the stock market's considered to be a leading indicator, and it looks ahead. And so, you know, isn't that kind of part of the, maybe the Wall Street narrative as well, is that, look, this is the darkest day, these are the darkest days, but the, you know, we'll bounce back?
As of March 2020, there was a lot of discussion about epidemics, as you well know.
Right.
This talk turned to an examination of the situation. For one thing that people did is look at the 1918 epidemic. It didn't have an obvious effect on the stock market. There was no crash. There was only a mild recession. They think this doesn't look like a classical cause of a depression. The story that the vaccine would come and stop the whole thing encouraged people to think that I should be in the market.
Right.
It was the vaccine story. So, you know, it wasn't really crazy to be in the market. You saw it trending upward. And a rational person listening to these stories doesn't know what is the truth. It's not crazy. But it's a story that influenced people because it was being told and retold. And it led you into an emotional swirl. I don't want to make the mistake of buying just before the top of the market. And I don't want to stay out of the market and see it keep on going up. So there's no answer to what one should do.
Right.
You can see the prominence of certain stories that were motivating for people to buy at this time.
And certainly the work from home, the fact that the tech stocks, the FANGs, or, you know, including Microsoft, did so well because there seemed to be clear winners coming out of the pandemic, right?
So the pandemic surge in the U.S. stock market, which made it the most highly priced market in the world, had largely to do with the boom in the information technology sector and the communication services sector. U.S. is the, I think, has the highest proportion in the world of such stocks. That's one reason why the U.S. stock market is the most overpriced in the world.
Ah, that's interesting. You used the word overpriced.
Overpriced. That is a narrative, by the way.
Uh-huh.
I'm asking people about whether the market is overpriced or underpriced. And or whether you're afraid of a crash. I've been asking that since the late 1990s. So we're torn between those, the idea that the stock market is trending upward, and maybe for good reason. There's the stay at home, the working at home mantra that's going around.
Right.
Maybe this is a fundamental change in the economy that we'll learn from what we're doing, and everything will be wonderful. I give some credence to that view. I can't say that any narrative is totally wrong.
Mm-hmm.
It's a question of how much they're emphasized in talk and in the news media.
So, Bob, it's always a mistake to use a word like overvalued with a reporter.
I know. Yeah.
I think you realize that. So let me ask you about that observation. How does the U.S. stock market's value look in terms of the CAPE ratio? And that, of course, is the cyclically adjusted price-to-earnings ratio. How does it look?
The CAPE ratio is, at this point of time, at one of its highest levels. In fact, for the United States.
Uh-huh.
For the United States, the only times when there was a higher CAPE ratio was just before the 1929 crash, and also just before the 2000 dot-com bubble burst. So it's very high, However, I've been pointing out, as have others, that there's also a very high bond market. Bond yields are very low.
Right.
And so the idea of pulling your money out of the stock market and putting it into the bond market is not so appealing, not the long-term bond market, because it yields to maturity there are, for the 10-year treasury are under 1% now.
Right.
So the excess return that we predict between U.S. stocks and U.S. 10-year treasuries is something like 4%. The stock market has been an amazing performer for over 100 years.
Uh-huh.
With the exception of 1929.
Right.
That's an interesting story. But overall, it's been doing very well. It's more like 10% a year, real. So it's not as good as it seemed before.
Uh-huh. But compared to the alternative, it's good, right? The stock market,
right.
Compared
to... It's riskier, but it's good, yeah.
Right.
So I think it has a place in one's portfolio.
Yeah.
I might add that other countries have lower CAPE ratios. The U.S. is the highest. And so if you want to consider stock market investing in general, it looks even better if you diversify across nations. If you go to individual countries, you could look at Russia as having just about the lowest CAPE ratio. a lot of people don't want to invest in Russia for various mistrusts that they have of the Russian government.
Right.
But it might be a good idea as part of one's portfolio when their CAPE ratio is under 10 and ours is over 30, it's quite a difference.
Mm-hmm. Depending on how speculative you want to get. I look at the Wall Street narratives a lot, and certainly there has been a narrative around for a long time called TINA. There is no alternative compared to the bond equivalent, which is what most people usually consider as investors. Do I invest in the bond market or the stock market? The bond market is not an alternative because it's so expensive and yields are so low. Sometimes narratives are true and sometimes they're not. What is the validity, do you think, from an investment point of view of TINA?
I think it's not all or nothing. You know that the return on the stock market is, we're not predicting it to be as high as it has historically. And it's still risky. I think it's in a risky phase.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's entirely reasonable to have shares in U.S. Stock market, and even in technology, which is highly priced. Information technology is a something that we can be patriotic about. The U.S. is a big success in this field. And the living at home experience is reminding us that things don't have to be done the way they've always been done. So that can cut the either way. It can encourage you to think that technology is a great stock investment, or it can make you afraid of losing your job, possibly to a robot. These things are still on our mind. They're long ago narratives that haven't disappeared completely.
Right, and as a matter of fact, that's a narrative that you covered, I mean, really, in a fascinating way in your book, Narrative Economics.
They had machine replacing jobs in ancient times.
Uh-huh.
But it never seemed that provocative until the 19th and 20th centuries. And now it's getting scarier. It might get scarier. If people realize that, for example, my job as a taxi driver, that looks like it's a fallback job that many people take. But we're getting driverless cars now, and people are working from home now, so we don't need so many of those. So people are saying, well, what's left for me? And that is a worry that I think might eventually drag the market down. At this point, I'm still in the market. I still think people should have some exposure to the U.S. market. There are narratives out there that are scary and that could bring the market down and the economy down.
Bob, are there ever times when there aren't scary narratives?
Well, the narratives never completely go away.
No.
And there are times. So I'll tell you a time when scary narratives were not prominent. New Year's Eve, 2000. Okay. up until that time, we had seen the news media was filled with stories about the internet and how it would change our lives, and about advanced technology. And scary narratives were still around; they just weren't in prominence then.
Right, and of course, you know, Irrational Exuberance, your bestseller has had several editions, came out in 2000 and basically warned about the tech bubble. Are you seeing any signs of irrational exuberance now in the markets?
The dominant, what is really interesting is there is a dominant narrative today. Then we can discuss. That narrative is Donald Trump. Whether you like him or dislike him, you have to know we're all fascinated by this man. And it's everywhere. Now, Donald Trump himself is a capitalist, and he cut taxes on corporations. He believes in making a deal. Let's make a deal. So the question is, how does that affect people's valuation of the stock market? Well, you might say it's who outnumbers who, the Trump supporters or the Trump detractors. You know, the election wasn't that far off from 50-50.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that his capitalist talk it just drew national attention more toward business. The story about that he was projecting is in our minds. And it makes, even if you don't think that it ought to affect the market, you might see it affecting the market. By the way, it's not just stocks and bonds that are highly priced. This is Tina again. It's also real estate.
Real estate. Of course, that's my next topic, is we're in the midst of a housing boom in this country, and it's also global. I mean, real estate prices are going up kind of around the world. What is your view of what's going on in the real estate markets? And again, in the midst of a global pandemic.
See, one of the problems we face is that our professional lives are divided up into different departments. And I just heard what you asked is a call to the psychiatry department. how does it affect people's, you know, buying into a risky stock market when it's soaring is a scary, emotionally difficult thing. And how you feel about that depends on how you feel about your relations with others and what are they thinking. And at the end of my book, I advocate focus groups.
Yes.
That would try to understand their thinking better. But I think we need to get them into the hands of historians, or historians of recent events, to try to put together why it is that there's an emotional reaction to Donald Trump, to the polarization, and to the... It may have stimulated a desire to take action now.
Back to the housing boom. What's going on?
We had a big drop in the housing market between 2006 and 2009.
Right.
The home prices didn't start recovering overall until 2012, but then they've been going up at a good pace. So what's going on here? I think there is a tendency, Tina is a good theory, actually.
Yes.
A tendency to overvalue all risky assets, this feeling of being left out. That I made a mistake. I regret not buying my house earlier, or my stocks, or my bonds. They've all done well, and it's not any more logical than that. It's reaffirming the when we have a rich president who lives in gold-plated fixtures around his house. It becomes a model even for people who don't like it. His success books emphasize living the life. You got to live the story, and it'll be true. So it's in our thinking. You have to associate with the right people. You have to send your kids to the right schools, and be a success and live like a success. That idea is coming back, and I think it's behind the housing boom as well.
It's just endlessly fascinating. So what is your advice to investors at a time like this when the U.S. stock market is, you know, overvalued historically, where the bond market is overvalued historically, where home prices have been soaring, you know, for several years? What's your advice to investors?
I think one should, this sounds very lame, I think one should diversify. Mm-hmm. A lot of, that's a standard advice, but a lot of people, so people who've been heavily in the U.S. stock market, congratulations, you've done well.
Okay. Absolutely.
But don't let it go to your head. That's a classic investing error. And think that maybe you should rebalance, or maybe even go more diversified than you've been in your investing life, because it's looking like stocks outside of the U.S. have much lower Cape ratios. And so diversify internationally and across asset classes. And as regards technology and growth stocks, I still think you could be right. The U.S. has been on a run, U.S. technology and growth stock, but they're highly priced now. And maybe you could identify some that are creative and adaptive to the present circumstance. I wouldn't rule it out, but I wouldn't go overwhelmingly into that either.
As far as the pandemic is concerned, how much of a game changer do you think the pandemic is going to turn out to be on the way we live our lives and the way the economy operates?
Yeah, well, it does look like we're getting a vaccine.
And yes.
That means the epidemic will slow, at least. If enough people take it, it will go away. And so it will leave us, it could leave us feeling essentially back where we were before. On the other hand, companies have been wary of letting employees work at home. But now that employees are seeing it happen, they like it. It's created a new culture. And in an office place, you don't see children running through the image and when you're on some kind of video connection.
Right.
But now we're used to seeing it. And so what's wrong with that? And maybe we don't have to dress to the hilt. Maybe we don't wear ties at home. So maybe we don't need to wear a tie at work anymore. It may get us back to fundamentals, and we may learn, it may be a better world, even if not measured as better by GDP. I'm impressed that people are thinking now that I ought to be able to work at home. You know, you may have roots in some part of the country or even abroad, and you want to live there with your relatives or your old friends. Why should a job uproot you anymore? And so I think this will make the economy much more efficient. We won't have to buy as much on clothes or real estate, or won't have to commute. It'll be a better world.
Bob, you know, we always ask the final question in a WealthTrack interview, if there's one investment that we should all own some of or make for a long-term diversified portfolio, what would it be? And I'll just say, the last time I talked to you, you did mention investing in yourself and your education. Yeah. Can you give us another one?
I think what I said last time also was index bonds, inflation index bonds. Those have a negative yield now.
Are these Treasury inflation-protected securities, for instance,
yeah,
TIPS?
Those are sometimes.
Right, right.
There is a worry now about outbreak of inflation again because of deficit spending. It doesn't seem real at all now. But you could put part of your portfolio into TIPS, even at a negative yield, because they may go up as we return to normal. And that means the price will go up.
It's a good thought. It's also a contrarian thought, and that means that this is a good time to buy them from a diversification point of view.
I tend to think in terms of aggregates. Mm-hmm. I still think technology, even though it looks overpriced, is a possibility. It doesn't fit into my original Cape network, we have had some strong performers. Now, there might be antitrust that will split these up. There are uncertainties about them. So, I wouldn't go overboard on that. But I think one could indulge oneself in some of those stocks.
Bob Shiller, it is always such a treat to have you on WealthTrack and, you know, hear your latest thoughts about what you're thinking about long-term and short-term. So we so appreciate your sharing your time with us.
It's nice to talk to you again, Consuelo.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is read Narrative Economics, How Stories Go Viral and Drive Major Economic Events by Robert Shiller. A pioneer in behavioral economics, Shiller recognized years ago that stories matter. What people believe and feel influences their buying and savings decisions. Multiply the effect and economies change. Shiller relates fascinating examples about how stories, both true and false, spread and take hold. You will never view the economy in quite the same way. Well, next week, Morningstar's personal finance guru Christine Benz on how the pandemic has changed financial planning. In this week's extra feature, we'll ask Bob Shiller how it's changed his life. Please continue to connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, and our YouTube channel. Thank you for watching. Have a super weekend and make the week ahead a healthy, profitable, and productive one.